Life after death, one of the more exciting topics to probably come across anyone's table. By a show of hands, how many people think that this afterlife is a fixed, already determined thing that you end up at if you live a decent, good, or holy life? Show of hands. Okay, good. So the Kabbalistic view on the hereafter and what exactly happens to the human experience upon leaving the physical world is shocking for a lot of people because it's a very different take than the various books that we've seen from other religious practices regarding what that afterlife seems to be. The Kabbalistic view is as follows. It is not a determined thing. It is being determined as we speak. So imagine as if you had an easel in front of you, just a blank easel standing maybe here, and you had a variety of colors, a couple paintbrushes, a kind of some tools you could create some beautiful picture with. And I had you come up and I asked you, please create for me your idyllic environment. You could draw it out. If you're a good painter, paint it for me. Show me the colors, show me the scene, the park, the trees, the flora. What would it look like to you? So undoubtedly, if each one came up and was to go ahead and create this image, it would probably be similar in some ways, but different in others. We each have a different vision of what a hereafter or a perfect world looks like. So here's the Kabbalistic response. The hereafter is being determined according to your every thought, word, and action. To say it differently, the hereafter is not something you end up at. It's something you are creating via what you develop in this world. It's a projection. It's an extension of what you make yourself to be. This is an important topic because often we think about the world beyond the world as something that we arrive at. You live your life, you play the game well, you know the rules. Everybody has a different idea of how to get through this life in a righteous manner. And you arrive somewhere, you end up somewhere. But what if the architect, the painter of that picture is in fact you? What you create in this world by your own efforts, the meditation you learn, the goodness you achieve, the people that you affect, the souls that you touch, everything that you're involved in is creating some part of this world, some part of this continuation. That's a very different idea than the hereafter as a fixed journey that one simply goes toward. So you are the architect of your journey. So if that's the case, I would imagine that if you could feel that when I think something about someone else, when I say a word to someone, when I behave in a certain manner, there is an implication for that motion, the likes of which will only truly become realized at a different time in the future. How would we paint that picture? What would you do? If you had a true understanding of it, what would every motion look like? Kabbalah tells us that one should move through life similar to playing a chess game. Every move counts. Don't think a pawn is ineffective. You can move a pawn and put a queen in checkmate. When we move through reality, we tend to think that some moments are irrelevant, inconsequential, not of any substance. The Kabbalistic model is there is no such thing as inconsequential. It doesn't exist. Every moment counts. So now, I want to take this to another level because the questions I typically hear from people is, what is the journey like? I leave this world. At some point, I close my eyes at 120 years of age and I leave reality. What happens next? What's the next thing? What goes on? One of the most famous psychiatrists who investigated what's called the near-death experience. Now, of course, this is not death. This is near-death. This is something that nobody really yet understands. But somewhere when the heart stops beating and the brain stops functioning, there's this experience that people all over the world have gone through. There's many, many details. But the one that seems to be ubiquitous is there's something about a light. And the light is almost indescribable. If you ask people what it's like, they simply say things like, it's love, it fills everything, it grabs onto every part of me. But I want to take the idea of light, because that concept is not just the one documented by the famous Raymond R. Moody, who's one of the most well-known psychiatrists in the field who documented this for 30, 40 plus years. But even certain mediums, people that have been trusted as authorities in this field, George Anderson, as an example, when he describes what it's like to have mediumship, and they ask him, well, if this person's already gone and you're having an experience with them, there's no body to have an experience with. How do you know the quality of the person? He says very simply, according to the brilliance of the soul, according to the nature of how they present themselves, I can determine what kind of life they lived. And he says the only way to really explain it is that a high-level soul shines. A low-level soul does not. It's dimmer. And he says, of course, this isn't actual physical light. It's another kind of light. But that's how he reports the nature of coming from the other side to us. Is there something about the quality of the light of the person that somehow speaks as to their righteousness or lack thereof? So, I want to give more of a Kabbalistic understanding as to what one should expect leaving this world and what the next immediate stage is. And it's a very detailed thing. We're going to give just some key points to it, but it'll make some sense to you. Kabbalah says as follows. When a person departs reality, one question is asked to them. So they obviously have to go through a transition from a world in which our physical senses are recording data at every given moment. And the next thing that happens upon cessation of this world is a single question. What is your name? That's the question that's asked. This is according to one of the great Kabbalists of the last 400 years, Rabbi Isaac Luria. Person leaves the world, they're asked the question, what is your name? And he says like this, if the person knows the name, I'm so-and-so, they can transition to the next stage. If the person says, I don't know, well, that's not a good answer. What happens then is, this is how he describes it, he is pursued, this is literal words, across the universe as these angels beat him until he recognizes his name. So right away you think, I think I'm going to stay in this world for a little while. It's a little depressing. But obviously, when you speak in terms of these descriptions, they're describing something much deeper. What does it mean, first of all, to know your name? What does it mean that lack of insight as to that name requires that he's pursued and somewhat shaken up? What does that refer to? So he says, and we'll say this very briefly, but it'll give us an understanding at least. The name that you give is not simply saying George, Smith, or Fred. It's not the name that we refer to each other as. The name that you say is in a response as to what the nature of you is. In other words, you're not responding back with a name. You're responding back with the following, hopefully, if you've done things right. I know myself. And the description you give to the question is not a label. It's the essence of what you are. Therefore, if someone lives their life in a way that it's an ongoing search every day, they don't get distracted by the things of the world that tend to preoccupy our focus and our attention and take us away from that mission. When the question is asked, who are you? The response back is, I know who I am. I know what I am. And that response allows transition to occur very easily. If the person says, I don't know, well, then something happens where they have struggle. What's that struggle refer to? They don't know where they belong. They partially feel attached to this world, but they also feel they're not part of this world any longer. The beating being referred to is not, God forbid, an actual beating. What it means is the internal conflict of leaving a world that they become completely subsumed by, while also trying to move into a reality that they never spent any time developing a sense of, becomes almost paralyzing. It's stuck somewhere in the middle. It can't move because it doesn't know either reality anymore. It doesn't know this or that. So transition is much more difficult. The beautiful language that the Talmud gives as to the difference between these two is the one who spends some time developing a sense of who their true identity and what their true identity is. They leave the world similar to plucking a hair out of milk. That's the description given in the Talmud. Plucking hair out of milk is rather easy. There's no resistance at all. To one who didn't spend that time, the struggle, the beating being referred to, is analogous to pulling cotton out of thorns. It's a much more messy, difficult job to detach each piece of cotton and not have it stretch and pull apart is difficult because the thorns resist it. It pulls it back. So one who feels torn, literally they can't identify with one or the other, is as if being beaten because you're struggling and you don't know where you belong. So part of transitioning is creating a sense of what the bridge is. So from a Kabbalistic perspective, since we paint the reality that we're moving into, we're painting that world. The more one has added color, the more one has spent time beautifying the picture, getting to know themselves, bringing out the soul, revealing their true spiritual nature, the more the hair comes out of milk. It's very easy. It doesn't have resistance. And transition is natural, almost welcomed. The more somebody becomes distracted by the vanity, and we say in Hebrew, the shtiyot, the stupidity of the world, things that preoccupy attention and don't give one the freedom to transition, the more one promotes the model of cotton from thorns. It's very difficult and it resists. So let's assume for the moment that we spend a good amount of our time becoming aware of who we are. We transition smoothly. We leave a physical consciousness and enter one that's different, but one that we're ready for because we've spent time getting to know it. I've often heard it said that if you think about, God forbid, someone's locked into a prison, we'll say solitary confinement, but it's worse than that. You shut the windows, you lock the doors, and there's no light allowed in whatsoever. If you took this individual who's spending years and years in this purgatory where they can't see, there's no interaction at all, and one day you say, I'm going to yank the walls down and let the light just come shining in. And how many years have they been in this little room confined? Let's say 95 years. That's all they know. They're fed through a little slot. They know nothing about the outside anymore. There is no interaction and there's zero light. And one day you bulldoze the walls down. What probably happens to this individual? Do they welcome the light? Not at all. The light for them is interference. It hurts. But let's say you wanted to take the same person and bring him or her out of the room. But you realize, for years and years now, they're trapped in this darkness. How does one begin to move someone out of one state to welcome another? So the answer is, slowly. You poke a hole into the wall. One ray comes in. They might struggle, but ultimately the eyes can adjust. So what do you do next? You poke a second hole and a third hole, and before you know it, the eyes adjust very easily. And then if you rip the walls down, transition is easy. They're used to the light. Developing a spiritual path means that the transition for us, hair coming out of milk, is you're taking this cell, and every time you turn inward to develop yourself and augment this spiritual identity that you have, you are poking holes in the prison of this world. You are poking holes and allowing another kind of light or awareness in. So when that moment comes that the walls come crashing down and you no longer can rely upon these physical, tactile senses that we have, guess what? You've been poking holes in those walls for so long that for you, the transition is seamless. It's easy. But if one does not have any way to move through those walls and you rip them down one day and the light comes blasting in, and there is no transition, there is no adjustment, is that going to be a welcome thing? No. It feels crushing, like punishment, when it really isn't. So the first level of transition is developing a lifestyle wherein which one does spend time inside, and typically if you're following a spiritual path of some sort and you're developing the sense of who you are, so when they ask you one day at a very ripe, ripe old age, who are you? The answer is easy. Of course I know who I am. I've spent years and decades developing a sense of that person. Then transition, easy. What happens next? What's the next stage in the process? Well, when we talked before about the souls of light that are always described, going through a tunnel, all these descriptions, you find this in Kabbalistic classics going back 2,000 years ago, describing the tunnel of light, describing a buzzing sound. all kinds of things that are involved in this transition. But here's where the story gets interesting. The first chamber, this is how it's described in the Zohar, the first chamber that one arrives at, this is how, and again, the descriptions give you a model that if you understand them in physical reality, you understand what it means at a higher dimension. Where do you end up? You end up in a chamber where the first thing the soul must do is immerse in a river, in quotations. It's put into this river. When it comes out of the river, it's given a certain number of vestments, of clothing. According to the number of articles of clothing that one has, determines exactly how bright this individual is. So if they receive 4 garments, 5 garments or more, it's brighter, brighter, and brighter. So I want to first start with the question about the river. What is this river for? If I go into a river, it makes sense physically. I have to clean myself and remove on any kind of taint, and I come out of the river and I'm pure. But in a non-physical reality, that are not bound by laws that we have here, what does that immersion refer to? So the answer is, to move into the future, you have to forget the past. When a person goes into a river, as we know from our own experience of water, we don't have gills, we don't have the equipment to breathe in water. When a person goes into a water environment and they immerse underneath, it's as if they no longer exist. There's no air. You don't have the fuel to be alive. You're in a different world now. So typically in religious practice, you go into a river to purify, because it marks in a way the end of one state and the beginning of a next. That's why mikvah, all kinds of immersion, are important practices. The river we're talking about here is the transition from a consciousness of this world to a whole nother consciousness. In other words, you go into the river to forget what you were attached to. So when he comes or she comes out of this experience, you're no longer bound or attached to anything of your previous identity. And what you're given then are all of the garments of your righteousness and all that you did in, going back to the thought, word, and deed idea, that the paint of your thoughts, your speech, and your actions, all that you created through living a spiritually mindful, righteous life, that's what's bequeathed to you. And when these things come on you, the brilliance of the individual is directly proportional to what they created through these brushstrokes. And that's what these vestments refer to. As most of us know, if you walk into a room with a certain kind of outfit, people have a sense of you. If you walk in, you're punked out, and you have the green spiky hair, and right? Doesn't mean that you're ignorant or you're stupid, but it's a statement. It's a statement about you, about something you want to show to the world. If I walk in like tonight with a suit and tie on, I'm making a statement. So clothing is always statement-oriented. When I show myself through clothing, the garments represent something. Hence the same thing here. The garments that you're given simply mean the expression of what you are through your paint in this world now becomes visible to all. So when George Anderson and others talked about these souls of light, and the more brilliant the light, the higher level, the more dim, the lower level, that's all it's referring to, is now the merit of the one comes out. What's important to realize as well is that the world is fluid. We say that even though somebody's on a wrong track, and this is quite a common question, I've not exactly been on the right track, so what do I do now? And the answer is, do better. You know, there's an interesting concept that's brought in the Kabbalistic writings that being in this world is similar to being in a womb. We think about being born into this world. According to Kabbalah, it's the opposite. You're born actually into a womb. And as we know from gestation, every moment counts. Every day counts, every week counts, every trimester counts, everything counts. You need to be in that womb. And the more someone is there, and if the mother is very mindful, plays music and good nutrition, then the more the fetus grows and develops and matures. So in a similar way, think about this entire world as being simply a womb, and every thought, word, and deed that we put into it is like good nutrition, or not. But if we spend the time taking not only a look at the world around us, but the world within us, and we turn in and we develop what we are and who we are, our transition to the outside and our transition beyond is not like cotton with thorns, but like a hair with milk. And similar to these bright souls whose vestments declare and reveal to the world just how deep these thoughts, words, and deeds were for them we merit the same kind of shining. So this is one way we understand the life after death process. So in summary, 3 points just to make regarding the topic. Number one, the idea of the hereafter is not some static world. It's a fluid one that's becoming. You are determining this reality by every move you make. Again, think of reality like a chess game. Every move matters. Secondly, the river immersion, the idea of knowing your name, is to really understand who you are. What is your time spent in this world doing? Discovering yourself. Make sure every day you spend time getting to know you, not just responding to the world around you, because that's the question that's ultimately asked. As for the river and the garments, all these simply are is a way to forget the past to welcome the present, transitioning from a terrestrial reality to one whose description I'm sure falls short in these books, something that people always report in these experiences as being blissful and being something altogether different than what we understand about this world. But we should know that we are the artist. We are the one creating, contributing, and growing this world. So yes, every move matters, but just like someone who takes a misstep, just step the other direction, because you're not condemned to walk one path only. Everybody makes mistakes, but the real question is, are you spending your time every day getting to know yourself?